Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Akabane101, and welcome back to another episode of Let's Play Bloodborne. In the last episode, I forgot to actually use up the rest of my cold bloods here, so I'm just going to spam these real quick before we take on Hemwick today, which Hemwick is going to be a fairly decent-sized area, definitely one of my favorite areas in the game, though. It has a lot of very unique Resident Evil 4 vibes to me. I don't know, you'll see it as we go along, maybe you'll have the same opinion as I do as we walk on in. But there's a lot of really unique Resident Evil feeling characters in the area. So let's go ahead and just channel some of these Blood Echoes here because they're going to waste if we decide not to use them. So here we go. Also, we can probably buy some Blood Vials, which I think we are running a little bit low here. In fact, let's go take a look. So 360 Blood Echoes per Blood Vial. We have 16 stored. Wow, we have a lot of Quicksilver bullets, 103 of those. Can we grab anything else that might be useful? Maybe some fire paper actually might be a good idea here. Yeah, let's go buy some fire paper. Now, at this point in the game, beasts are becoming less common, I guess you could say. So, as we wander throughout this title, beasts will slowly kind of dwindle, and then we'll be seeing a new sort of enemy, I guess, as we go along. Alright, let's see what we got here. I think I can upgrade my gear with the Blood Gem Fortification. Anything slightly better here? Oh, HP continues to recover +2. Now, if you're wondering if that's any good, I'll be honest with you, it's not particularly that powerful. Only if you go to the Chalice Dungeons to get things that give you, like, +5 HP recovery, and you put, like, 3 of those gems in there, so you have 15 HP recovery per tick or per second, however the system works in this game. Then it's kind of reasonable regeneration, but you are sacrificing a lot of damage just for that HP recovery. So at the end of the day, HP recovery in Bloodborne is not going to be your end-all, be-all way of survival. It's not going to be like Diablo. I know I come back to that game all the time, but it's such a good game to compare this game to. I don't know why. But like in Diablo, you have lots of regeneration and regenerative powers and all that. Whereas in this one, not so much. You know, you're not going to have crazy good regeneration, and there's no, like, on hit you regenerate either, which is also a little bit unfortunate, but I can see it in the sense of trying to balance the game for multiplayer. That'd be kind of overpowered if someone hit you and got all their HP back, and you have no way of really countering that. Alright, let's go ahead and wander into Hemwick, which actually I think we just unlocked a new tomb here. Ah, this is the tomb for the abandoned old workshop. Not really an area that's necessary at the moment, but we unlocked the second tomb, which is Hemwick Charnel Lanne. Let's go in. Alright, welcome back to Hemwick Charnel Lanne. Again, one of my favorite locations in all of Bloodborne. This is like the culmination of beasts and all that stuff. It's a lot of fun. Very, very cool. And, you may have heard them, but these screaming ladies are absolutely insane. Custom animations and everything specifically for these types of characters, they've gone so nuts they're actually just dancing. Are these the people the cause of all the tombs? Quite possibly. There's one woman that's actually just crying in the corner here. Maybe she's not entirely turned just yet. But in this entire area, you can kind of see that these people have turned. There's even a giant statue of a person with like one of those iron bars, whatever. That's really weird. Such a weird character in this game, and this is the only time you really run into female opponents until maybe a bit later in the game. But these are just standard enemies, very similar to the Yharnamites. A bit more tough than the Yharnamites even. These guys take 3 hits to kill, probably because of a balancing issue. They didn't want the player to run in here and, you know, have as easy of a time as they were having in Yharnam. I can only imagine. So, they balanced it in a way to give us a little bit more challenge. Poor man's blood gemstone. That's a triangle there. I want to actually see if that's any good. Let's go check it out. Physical up near death. Oh, okay. So that's very similar to the red tearstone ring. If you don't know what the red tearstone ring is, basically when you're low on HP, you'll start doing more damage. You'll get a stagnant buff in Dark Souls 1. We got ourselves some more of those bloodshot eyeballs that we received in the last episode. This has a lot of significance in this world. And as we wander through here, a lot of references to eyes and eyes being scooped out and all that are going to be shown about. Basically, for now, I'll explain that the witches of Hemwick and a lot of characters in the world are searching for eyes on the inside. Eyes play a significant role in all of Bloodborne. And there's a huge significance just by, you know, looking at the word insight. I mean, if you go to the top right there, you see there's an eye for our insight, which, how do you get eyes? Well, you have to get Madman's knowledge, and you also can read up on this stuff a little bit here, on the one-third of the umbilical cord, which we got from the abandoned workshop, which at the very bottom line, it says, used to gain insight, or so they say, eyes on the inside, although no one remembers what that truly entails. So, are these people gathering eyes? It's likely so. And they might be using them for something, but we don't know what it is yet.
Did you hear the graveyard murmurs? Then it's almost time. Oh, I can't wait. I just can't wait.
More ladies here going crazy, going nuts. All these bodies here completely just skewered and tied up. Some of them upside down, some of them just kind of strung normally, probably in haste for the most part. They probably ran out of tombs and locations to bury people. Now this location over here, this is a shortcut. We cannot access this just yet. We're going to have to access it a little bit later. Very easy to miss if you're not looking in the right spot, although also very easy to see if you're looking in the right spot as well. I always love those types of shortcuts where it's like, oh darn, I just barely missed it without even realizing. Ellie there took a little bit of extra damage because of counter hits. Basically, if an enemy hits you and you hit them back and they, you know, regardless of if they hit or connect or whatever, you'll be able to do a little bit of additional damage. It's called a counter. In that case. Whereas when you shoot them with a gun and they fall over, that's called a stagger. Alright, so what we're trying to do here, we're trying to get this freaking dog to come over here, but he doesn't want to. There we go. Look at that. Hey, little guy. If you wait patiently, the dog will aggro you before the lady over here. And you may notice there is a woman throwing Molotovs at us. Like she just don't care. Alright, let her throw another one. We're just gonna charge up the side here, which of course they had to put a troll fence in the way. Because thank you, FromSoft. Thank you, Miyazaki. Oh man, no! Him again, okay. Whew. Miyazaki means business. Alright, we got a lady with a mallet and a lady with a hot iron, which again looks very similar to this little hot iron over here. Although, is that wielded by a man? Is that a beard? I can't quite tell. It's probably a woman. I don't know. Not that it holds any significance whatsoever. Other than this area is just infested with just crazy ladies. Which kind of sounds horrible. It's infested with women. What? But, yeah, it's interesting. I like that this place is just, like, focused on just, you know, female-only crazy old ladies. That probably had a lot of cats. But in this case, some of them had dogs. I'm surprised they never went down, like, the cat route. This area, that'd be really funny. I don't know, maybe it would be out of place though. I could probably agree with that. Hello sir, would you like to have a little bit of a stagger? No you won't. Okay, I understand you don't like getting staggered, fair enough, but we gotta have this brawl here, sir. We gotta have this brawl. All right there we go. Okay, we got lucky there. I will admit that did not go as planned. Okay. Sometimes, you just don't get the stagger. And you just gotta deal with it. Aha! There we go! Have at thee, foul demon! Beautiful. Totally forgot to use my blood bullets earlier. Would have saved myself a couple of extra blood vials there. What a lot of people like to do, they like to actually top themselves off and keep it so their blood vial count is below... Ooh, nice. Below 20 blood vials, so it doesn't go directly to their stock. Other people, like a German spy, like to max out their blood vials as soon as possible. That means that a lot of enemies, if they drop... Oh, jeez.
If they drop loot, and since your stockpiles are completely full, they won't be able to give you any items, so you'll just have all these blood vials and quicksilver bullets strewn around the entire zone, and if you ever start losing some blood vials, you can go grab some. Which is actually a pretty genius idea. I like that a lot. But I can't really implement that strategy right now, so the only really chance I got of getting these blood vials back is if I top off my HP. But then again, I don't want to waste it entirely. So right here, there's going to be a bunch of crows. We're going to try and dance around this guy. That's only the first of many crows. There's actually 1,000 billion over here. Just wait for it. There they are. Look at them all. Now, if you don't want to actually engage them, we can just throw a Molotov cocktail here. See if you got a good chance. Yeah, there you go. Now, I think we killed the one that's actually docile. One of these birds don't actually engage you. I think it's the one in the front. Yep, the one in the front. He doesn't actually engage at all. I'm trying to see if I can finish off some of these guys, but the one enemy in the front was actually giving him an invisible wall. He couldn't fly over him, which is actually interesting to note. So if you see multiple ravens, if they're all in a row, they're going to have a difficult time trying to do... Oh, God! I'm sorry, sir. I was trying to use my monocle on him. And I murdered him. I'm sorry. In cold blood, too. Oh, no. Well, he's dead now. But this bird was not going to engage with us. I mean, we're obviously trying to see if it was going to aggro, and it didn't. It was just standing still. So I'm sorry, Mr. Raven. I'm very sorry. This is that shortcut that we saw earlier that I said that it's easy to miss. A lot of players might just completely ignore those birds. If you just walk straight across and kill this bird here, you're probably not going to be likely to look right. You're probably going to look left towards the bridge. However, if you hear any of the birds over here, it'll attract your attention. You might fight them. And on your turn around here, there you go. You got yourself an elevator. Although that didn't happen to me. I think I completely skipped the birds my first time playing this game. And I just never saw the shortcut. Never used it either. Because I think there's a second shortcut coming up. Oh, jeez. Very pushy, lady. Very soon here. Sometimes enemies still completely catch me off guard. There we go. Again, I don't really use the Kirkhammer's hammer, which is kind of weird. I don't know why that is. So right here, actually I do know why that is. I've explained it in a previous episode. It's more of a utility item for backstabs and massive damage, but right now, not so much. They didn't patch this guy to like walk up, did they? Usually he comes back down and you fight him on the bridge. Anyway, if you move up, you'll be attacked by a bunch of ladies, so it's probably a better idea to kind of trigger him and have him come back down the bridge. There's a good chance you could die here because obviously you could be pushed off the bridge. We'll hope that doesn't happen. And of course, I got the stagger, but I'm a failure and I messed up. All right, there we go. Oh, look at that leap. That was some pretty impressive leaping. There you go. He's giving me all the easy attacks. He's feeling good. The game's playing nice with me today. I don't know what it is. But I still can't believe I threw a Molotov cocktail at that Raven. Rest in peace, Raven. You did not long for this world. But, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I killed you in cold blood. Alright, let's just heal up. Is this enough HP? You know what? Let's top up. Let's use my rule of thumb of just, like, healing all the things. Look how many graves there are out here. It's just absolutely insane. This right here also reminds me a lot of Resident Evil. You see the body on the inside moving around, throwing Molotov cocktails on itself. It's always great. I don't know why, it just has that Resident Evil 4 vibe to me. Excuse me. Alright. Eat 'em! Delicious. Delicious murder. Okay, so now, I don't think there's any other enemies in here, but let's just kind of clear out the area. Completely ensure that we are safe. Alright, now let's examine a dead body. Hello, Mr. Horse. So we've seen horses like this before. And if you... Again, don't Google them, but if you want to, you can Google these. Just be warned. But a lot of people have said things along the lines of... Oh shit, where do you people come from? You guys didn't exist here before. Maybe they did, and I'm just crazy. But, you know... My moderator on Twitch, Starving Walrus, I believe, linked a photo to a decaying horse, and basically their eyes disappear pretty soon. So some people have equated these guys, you know, being so decayed as they are, that their eyes have disappeared, because that's just what happens first to most organisms. When you die, your eyes are probably the first to go, because they are made of, I guess, a fairly different material from your skin and internal organs. I can only imagine. Man, I'm so happy I picked up this monocle. Typically, I don't use it, but it's like the Let's Player's Guide to the Galaxy. It's just so good. You need it. You need it in the world. But yeah, I mean, I like to equate it to the witches actually scooped out the eyes of the horses in the world, whereas, you know, in this case, they're still decaying, sure, but I think the eyes were perfectly removed. There's no, like, residue. Hey! No! Don't leave! Okay, here we go. I almost missed him. I saw him scurrying away, and he was like, nah, man. We're good, man. Got some bloodshot eyeballs here. Again, let's go reread the bloodshot eyeballs just for this episode in particular, because it's so relevant here. An exquisite eyeball removed quickly after death, or perhaps even before, used to unlock the seal of the old labyrinth hinter tombs. Well, that part doesn't matter, because holy chalice stuff doesn't matter at all, from what I'm trying to make as a point. But again, removed quickly, or just before or after death, and that's definitely a possibility here. And again, it's all speculation. I mean, there's no exact right or wrong for what's about to happen here. It's a pretty close difference between the two. Of, like, if it decayed, or if it was, or if the eyes were scooped out. So here we can see that just next to this lake, there is a item there, which is, I think, the lake rune. But we should go all the way around, because if you drop down there, there's going to be like 30 dogs. I'm not even exaggerating. It'd be like 30 dogs about to attack you, so probably not a good idea to just rush on down. There you go. You can already see two of them there. There's a good portion of dogs down there. Third one. It's about 4 or 5. Yeah, I'm going to go with about 5 or 6 dogs in total. Not fun to fight. Not going to lie. Thanks for the easy stagger there, good sir. Let me just do a nice little visceral attack on your face. There we go. That was a little bit risky there. If that actually didn't go through, I'm sure you would have done a serious amount of damage to me. Ooh, damn. Good hit, lady. Alright, incoming doge. This dog might actually run into this fire here. If we're a little bit careful, we might actually get an aggro. But he needs to be facing me. And that's a little bit more difficult. Hey! Looks like another lady joined the fight. Alright. I do like the look of the dogs here. They look very, very scary in comparison. Oh no, did not mean I should do that. Oh boy. I did a jumping attack, which is flicking the left stick forward and then hitting R2, which will make you do a leaping strike. Very useful in certain situations. Huge tell if you're playing PvP, so not very useful there, but can be useful. Just there, I was trying to actually just do a stabby attack, and hold down R2 attack. So I don't believe there's anything down here that we can grab, but I'm just going to double check, just to be sure. Alright. So right here, it's pretty scary. We're going to be running into 2 armored dudes here. These guys were in the beginning of the game. They are not easy to kill. Only with staggers do I find them to be easy, in any respect. But if you find yourself having trouble with them, backstabs all day. And even I run into issues of trying to actually get the backstabs here, so I'm just gonna drop down on the side. Never expect there's only just one way into a zone. And before we even continue on, let's go ahead and open up a shortcut. We're gonna call it a side cut. The short side cut. There you go. This will allow us to actually run away if we have to. Alright. Let's get a little bit more anger on this guy. There you go. He leaves his back open quite often here. Problem is, it's not particularly the easiest thing to get the backstab either. You just kind of have the hope that you're getting lucky attacks from the guy. Like those little charge attacks where he's trying to grab you. Which absolutely would do significant damage, but if you get lucky and you actually get that animation, you get the stagger on him, you can do pretty well for yourself. The little, fast animations like that, which these guys love to do. They make it a bit of a pain here, because if you look at his right hand, that's how fast he's moving his hand to do the attack. For example, there was a charge attack, but he had so much poise on it, it didn't work out for us at all, which just makes it so difficult. I'll try and get a few more blood bullets! Look at him just dashing in. Aha! There we go. Sneaked off a little bit of a shot right at the end there. Gave us a nice, easy time. Alright. Let's go ahead. Grab some thick, cold blood. Wonderful. And, of course, as you can see, this is where we just were. Also, a bunch of bodies here. These are very small, frail bodies, like they haven't eaten in a long time. Most likely just consumed and discarded very quickly for their eyes. Again, we can't really see their eyes, so it's all speculation, but we're led to believe that is the case. Look how many dead people there are. Now, it looks like they are wearing skirts, so these must be other women of the village. And all that, hung and tied up. Also, bandages on the right arm. Although, they don't look like they're turning into monsters or beasts or anything like that. Bit different. This thing here sticks out like a sore thumb. Although, even though I say that, it's probably not true to most people. It can be very easy to not see this obelisk, but it plays in a significant role later on. So just remember that it's there. Oh man. Oh god, I hate dogs. I hate doges. I love them in real life, hate them in the game. What is it with games making dogs so cruel, so evil? There's these vicious monstrosities. I'm surprised people don't make dogs like main villains in video games at this point. Can you imagine? The most evil villain of all time is just a dog. And it's just like the most rabid monstrosity of a beast you've ever seen. Look how many dogs there are. See, I was not exaggerating saying 30 dogs. Like, that is what I feel like I've just fought there. Those dogs are not fun. And I'm just going to top myself off here before we move on. All right. So now we got one more dog to fight. Luckily, we bought the extra fire paper, huh? Helped us out with those beasts. Alright, let's try and finish off the dog, which we get hit by a couple of Molotov cocktails, but to be fair, I think that was a good trade. One blood vial for one kill. In that particular circumstance, I feel like that's fair. There we go. Some more thick cold blood. Lots of echoes in this area, so we're definitely going to head back before we finish off this boss fight. However, remember that item that we saw up there? Yeah, there we go. Keen eye finds all things. And we found a lake. And you know what? I'm going to leave this little side passage before we get knocked over or something. Trust me, it'll happen. If you're not careful, it'll happen. So this right here gives us physical damage reduction plus 3%, and it's also called the Lake Rune, which plays a pretty good significance in the game's role. Lots of lake runes in this game, though. Like, most Karo runes, I think, share the same description of the lake. A Karo rune that transcribes inhuman sounds. This transcription of the Great Ones in human voices ripples like a watery reflection. This rune means lake, and those who memorize it enjoy reduced physical damage. Great volumes of water serve as a bulwark guarding sleep and an auger of the Eldritch Truth. Overcome this hindrance and seek what is yours. Very cool. So now, this is a lake in the center of the massive area that we're in. We're basically, throughout the entirety of the game, we're going to be going around in a giant circle around this lake. And even the lake itself plays significance in the role of the story, particularly in Bergenworth when we get there. Oh man, I just love the look of this place. Ah, I just get so giddy. It's so cool. It's so cool. I don't know. I've never had a game just be so interesting to look at and so unique. That. Well, I guess you can't say unique, but there's no other game that feels like this other than, like, maybe Resident Evil 4 when you go to the very first village. It's like, where's everyone going? Bingo. But, like, jeez, man. Oh, so good. So good. Love that game. Love that game. Love this game too. Love those vibes. So there's a couple of ladies up there that are going to want to fight us. I really just want to pull this guy over to the side and maybe get a hit here before we get mauled. There we go. Yes! Excellent. So right behind him, there is a treasure chest, which we're going to ignore so that we may actually fight these scary ladies with mallets and stuff. Oh, jeez. Oh, okay. These ladies mean business. My god. I feel like that could be a movie. The three ladies, the Molotov, the mallet, and the hot iron. I'm sure someone can tell me what that looks like, or what that actually is, the hot iron lady. But to me, it looks like someone took a hot iron and stuck it to the end of a pole arm and was like, yep, that's a weapon. That's a weapon right there. Yeah. You can have your weapon and eat it too. Alright, how are we doing on inventory? I think, what we should do... Oh, we already have Bold Hunter marks put on here. Hey, good job, past self. Putting those Bold Hunter marks on that little item there. Alright, so what we're gonna do, we're gonna head on over where we killed that giant. We're gonna steal the item inside the treasure chest right behind him. To get the Tempering Blood Gemstone. Very strong triangle item, I believe. Yeah, physical attack plus 4.2% and... add slow poison effect, so we're going to be doing a slight buildup of poison damage over time on enemies with this thing. Very, very cool. Not significant enough to like really get like poison going on, but it's something there, and it's reasonable enough, I guess you could say. Alright, so far so good. Let's go ahead and run into the boss fight, but we're not going to fight the boss. I'm actually going to show you guys an easy way to take her on, and you know, Bloodborne veterans can be like, oh no, he's gonna do it the easy way. But I want to show people the easiest ways to get through this game, because I think it's a lot of fun. Is there a little guy in here? I swear it's supposed to be like a wandering madness in here. Maybe I missed him. Hey, there he is! There he went. He was hiding up top, waiting for us to knock over those barrels or something. Oh, nice. Yeah, this is also another reason why we gotta head back, because those... Twin Bloodstone Shards. How many do we have? We got 9 of them. Very good. So 5, 6, 7, 8. Sweet. Yes, I just had to do basic math to figure out how many I needed to level up to +5. I'm sorry, guys. Alright, so we're going to have our Bold Hunter mark ready to go. We're going to run into the fight. Let it spawn on in so we gather the insight here. And then we're just going to run away. Alright, and with that, we're gonna head back straight to the Hunter's Dream. Alright, so now that we're back in the Hunter's Dream, let's go ahead and use all the cold blood that we may have found. I could have sworn we found more than this, but hey. Extra 3,600 blood echoes, never hurt nobody. Which, I guess if you think of that in a double negative sense, it absolutely hurt everyone, so oops. Alright, let's go ahead and talk to this lady here. Kind doll lady, which I kill all the time because I'm a jerk. Here we go, vitality upgraded, finally! And look at that, just in time. So we got 20-20-20 on all those things. Very, very good. Now I think it's a good time to start leveling up our strength to around 30-ish, 25-30. And then endurance maybe, but I think now we're going to do a little bit of a flip on endurance and vitality and maybe start getting vitality up there for more survivability and all that, right? Awesome. Okay, now we have to find a way to get rid of all this insight. Now, we could go to a brain sucker and have the brain sucker, you know, suck out all our eyes in our brain or something like that, but the insight in our brain. But let's go ahead and purchase some things that we haven't already, like the Sinister Resonant Bell and maybe even a few more fire papers. Yeah, let's go buy a few more fire papers. Now, don't be fooled. We're not buying 3 fire papers at once. That's how many we currently have. We're buying 1 fire paper per 1 insight, so keep that in mind. Let's go ahead and spend all our insight. There we go. Now we know nothing about the world, and if we were to come back here, the doll herself would actually be sitting down, but since we were here, the doll is not going to reanimate and teleport into a sitting position. So for now, since we saw her before we lost insight, we have like lingering insight, if you want to call it that. But yeah, we got a few more fire items and the Sinister Resonant Bell. I might as well read that, right?
A bloodstained bell discovered in the old underground labyrinth. One of the resonating bells that cross the gaps of worlds. But this one, knells for misfortune and malice. The sinister bell is an object of dark thoughts. Ring it to become the enemy of a hunter in another world. And of course, it's online use only, so useless for this playthrough at this point, because I don't have PlayStation Plus anymore. However, with the rest of our blood echoes here, I think we'll just buy as many blood vials as we can. Just in case we somehow die, still a possibility, although not extremely easy to die now that we have zero insight, because this has radically changed the fight. And let's go back to Hemwick Charnel Lanne. So the shortcut that we unlocked in the corner there with the elevator, that in particular is going to be useless now. The most unfortunate thing about it is once you unlock the second shortcut, which we already did, renders that elevator almost entirely useless. Although, I guess actually, I'm a little bit wrong on that front. We could have used it, and then we could have just run through this area, just ran backwards from the stairs, so I guess maybe I'm wrong on that front. But both ways seem relatively the same speed. Maybe the elevator route's a bit safer, though. Yeah, actually, now that I think about it, I think the elevator route is safer. So, apologies about that. So take the elevator, just run backwards, though, from where you are. So don't go out the bridge, go away from the bridge. Luke, don't go towards the bridge. I have the higher ground. Wait, that's the wrong Star Wars movie. Oops. That's Star Wars Episode 3. Alright, let's try and dodge around these ladies now that they're nice and distracted. And the fog gate should be up and ready to go here. There it is, nice and faint. We'll just sneak on through. And now, remember that guy in the middle? Yeah, he's kind of gone now. And all that remains are these ladies here, which you can backstab. This is the Witch of Hemwick, but there's two of them. The game is a liar, a dirty liar to you. Don't ever believe what the game says. But yes, the one... Oh, hello. That was the other witch that we just ran into, so... one doesn't have a health bar, the other does have a health bar. Once the first one dies, the other one will reveal their health bar, and then both health bars will be on screen, because basically they can resurrect each other. So we're just going to keep doing damage here. It really doesn't matter if you're doing massive amounts of damage to these here witches. Because even if you kill one, it doesn't affect anything in the fight, because with zero insight, we just can't comprehend that there's another monster in the room. And even though that's the case, they can't actually affect us, because we can't see them, and they pretty much can't see us either. However, if you were doing this fight the legitimate way, without, like, getting rid of all of your insight, you will find it to be a little bit more challenging. It's more like a hide-and-seek adventure. A lot of the time. Basically, you try and sneak around the area, trying to locate these witches who are invisible. They have various magical abilities. Some of them can lock you up into one small position. Oh, there you go. She can do massive damage there. I'm actually going to back up before she keeps spamming that ability to kill me. As you can see, we still took significant damage there. We don't have arcane resistance, which is what these ladies are capable of. So this is the second era lady here. And we were actually doing damage to her, even though you didn't see any health bars going down. Hello? She literally just teleported inches away from herself. So yeah, it pretty much makes the fight pretty much breeze for the most part. But I enjoy the fact that you have a choice to do this in case, like, you're just having a bad day, having a rough time, and you're like, you know what? Let's make these witches have a bad time, too. You may also see, oh shit, what am I doing? You may also see that they have eyes on them. Let's see if I can get a better look at these witches here. Are these lovely little ladies? Oh, they're trying to grab me, huh? Trying to grab me. I see your friend here. Here we go. You look very closely. They have eyes all over their body. It's really gross. I think that might have been the main witch. I'm not sure, though. But if you stand in front of them for too long, you might find yourself getting killed pretty easily. Oh, darn. All right, well, just keep hitting him. No! Okay, so if we take a little bit too long here, the other witch
will resurrect her friend. So I have to watch out for that. She's now using magical abilities, which will do massive damage to us, but luckily we're on a slope, so that works out. There is a bug in the game that allows us to do this, so it works out. All right, let's try and sneak around if we can. There we go. Massive amounts of damage incoming. She might actually resurrect her friend in time here. Oh, there she is. She didn't even teleport very far. It's kind of funny. Let's try and get this. Here we go. Great back attack. Finish her off. Finish him. All right, now this is where we gain insight from the kill, and we're about to see that there are other enemies in the area. There he is. Right when you get the insight, you see these guys die. I think that's so cool. What a great touch to still like show that, hey, these guys are actually in the area, but since you can't comprehend them, since you can't see them, these enemies are too weak to actually affect you in the real world. I don't know if it's actually real or not, but yeah, it's very dark and dank. That's what it is. Let's go with that. Activate this lovely light lamp, but don't be fooled. It's not over yet. It's not over yet, Snake. Let's go over here and find out what these ladies were actually hiding away. There is a reason to go down this optional route. There's no reason to go here other than for this item, which is a very useful item. So we can see here there was a hunter who looks like his pelvis was completely impaled or crushed or something on those lines. That's how it always looks like to me. Or his eyes were just ripped out of his skull and there's just blood everywhere. One of the two. I like to think that his pelvis was crushed because these ladies look crazy like that. They look insane. Arms bound to the chair, although I don't believe the legs. Yeah, the legs were not bound. So this guy probably could have stood up. Or kicked or struggled in some way, but I guess he just felt like he couldn't. I don't know. Anyway, let's go ahead and loot what he has, right? The rune workshop tool. Yes, there we go. This is going to allow us to do things with Carol runes. And we have four of them now, so that's great. Runesmith Carol, student of Bergenworth, transcribed the inhuman utterings of the Great Ones into what are now called Carol runes. The hunter who retrieves this workshop tool can etch Carol runes into the mind to attain their wondrous strength. Provost Willem would have been proud of Carol's runes, as they do not rely upon blood in any measure. So this tells us about Willem, and Willem is part of the healing church in this game, and the fact that he does not like blood. But the healing church is all about blood. So actually, William is before the healing church. I lied to you a little bit there. Yeah, Willem against blood. Does not like blood. Although, we'll learn more about Willem as time goes on. But now we've gained access to using all of these things, and we have to go back to the workshop to go ahead and equip those. But we are done with Hemwick. I think we did 100% of the area. We'll only have to come back here just a little bit later in the game, once we go back to Yosefka's Clinic for realsies, like the real area of Yosefka's Clinic. That's when we can actually come back here to Hemwick, where it plays a bigger role. Alright, so unfortunately, since we did get our insight back, the doll is still standing. We still understand that, hey, this is a doll, but it is talking to me. But that is totally fine. Let's go ahead and see how to use these Carol runes, which are very useful indeed. Memorize a Carol rune to acquire its eldritch strength. Lots of eldritch stuff, lots of darkness, lots of dankness, lots of weird, weird stuff. Eyes on the inside, insanity, insight, all this stuff. It's leading to one type of thing. And someone's already guessed it in the comments already, which is very, very cool. Let's go ahead and get Formless Odin for the max Quicksilver bullets held, plus 4. Let's go damage reduction. And we also have Beast here. Now, Beast is okay if you want to do Beast transformations. For now, we only have one Beast rune, and yes, there's multiple runes. Actually, you might notice that some of these are more faded. So, for example, the lake's a bit faded. The communion in general, actually, right here. Very noticeably, this is faded quite a bit, which signifies how strong the power is of when, like, this rune is probably made. So it's kind of like an idea of aging, but also a balancing mechanic in the game. So yeah, they offer multiple of each types of Carol runes. Anywho, we're going to get Communion, which increases our max vials up plus 1. There's a fourth one here. It's called an Oath Memory. So if you remember in Dark Souls 1, there is a covenant, or many covenants that you can join. This is the same idea, although you use Carol runes to join a covenant. So you can actually switch and interchange between covenants every time you come back to the Hunter's Dream. And in fact, this is how people end up doing PvP sometimes in Hunter's Dream. If you're playing online and you see a bunch of blood pools down here, you'll see like Vile Bloods and Executioners fighting each other because they oppose each other. So if you you go into co-op in this area and you happen to be on either side of the line, you'll actually be enter the area as a purple name and be able to PvP. Although it's a little bit archaic. It sounds archaic anyway. I'd say just go to the makeshift altar and then join someone that way, but eh. To each your own, right? To each your own. Let's go ahead and level up with the doll.
Welcome. Very well.
And I guess we can increase our damage here. Now let's see if skill helps out at all in comparison. Now it seems like strength is definitely going to be getting the huge benefits here between level 20 and 40. Level 20, like I said, really kicks off the amount of points that you get, and it's a good threshold to start at for realizing how much strength you can get out of something, so it's a lot of fun. Regardless, guys, I'm gonna wrap up this episode. Thank you so much for watching me play through Hemwick, one of my favorite areas in Bloodborne, and we'll be continuing on tomorrow, going back to that Cathedral Ward, and checking on possibly Eileen after the boss. Pretty cool, right? See you all next time.